And I don't have a God that I can create in the place I live with the money I make. I have a God, He made everything. So I don't need a temporary man-made deity. When I got the real thing, I got the real thing, yeah. The Lord of all the earth, maker of all things, He alone is the one true God. Kingdoms rise and fall, but even through it all, He remains the one true God. Yeah. I don't have a thing that I got on my own. I don't have a care that I carry alone. But I have a God who's carrying me. Yeah. And I don't have a sin that He doesn't forgive. And I don't have a heart that is worthy of His. But I have a God who still loves me. So I don't need a temporary man-made deity. When I've got the real thing, I've got the real thing, yeah. The Lord of all the earth, the maker of all things, He alone is the one true God. Kingdoms rise and fall, but even through it all, He remains the one true God.
Who is this King of glory, Lord strong and mighty? Who is this King of glory, Lord strong and mighty? Who is this King of glory? Who is this King of glory?
He's the Lord of all the earth, maker of all things, He alone is the one true God. Kingdoms rise and fall, but even through it all, He remains the one true God.
He is Lord of all the earth, maker of all things, He alone is the one true God.
Kingdoms rise and fall, but even through it all, He remains the one true God. Yeah, yeah.
He is the one true God.
I don't have a God I can put on the stand. And I don't have a God I can hold in my hand. But I have a God holding me.
Good morning. Welcome to worship here at Gloria Dei Lutheran Church on this seventh Sunday of Easter. We are so glad that you could join us and be here as we worship our God together. Please take a moment now to center yourself. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are raised with Him to new life. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give you thanks, O God, from in the beginning you created us in your image. and planted us in a well-watered garden. In the desert, you promised pools of water for the parched, and you gave us water from the rock. When we did not know the way, you sent the good shepherd to lead us to still waters. At the cross, you watered us from Jesus' wounded side, and on this day, you shower us again with the water of life. We praise you for your salvation through water, for the water in this font, and for water everywhere. Bathe us in your forgiveness, grace, and love. Satisfy the thirsty, and give us the life only you can give. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Please join me in prayer. Almighty and living God, you hold together all things in heaven and on earth. In your great mercy, receive the prayers of all your children, and give to all the world the spirit of your truth and peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from 1 Peter. Who will harm you if you are eager to do what is good? But even if you do suffer for doing what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear what they fear, and do not be intimidated. But in your hearts sanctify Christ as Lord. Always be ready to make your defense to anyone who demands from you an accounting for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and reverence. Keep your conscience clear so that when you are maligned, those who abuse you for your good conduct in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if suffering should be God's will, than to suffer for doing evil. For Christ also suffered for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, in order to bring you to God. He was put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which also he went and made a proclamation to the spirits in prison, who in former times did not obey, when God waited patiently in the days of Noah during the building of the ark, in which a few, that is, eight persons, were saved through water. And baptism, which this prefigured, now saves you. Not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience, through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers made subject to him. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
A reading from Acts. Paul stood in front of the Areopagus and said, Athenians, I see how extremely religious you are in every way. For as I went through the city and looked carefully at the objects of your worship, I found among them an altar with the inscription, To an Unknown God. What, therefore, you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it, he who is Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in shrines made by human hands, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mortals life and breath and all things. From one ancestor he made all nations to inhabit the whole earth, and he allotted the times of their existence and the boundaries of the places where they would live, so that they would search for God and perhaps grope for him and find him, though indeed he is not far from each one of us. In him we live and move and have our being, as even some of your own poets have said, for we too are his offspring. Since we are God's offspring, we ought not to think that the deity is like gold, silver, or stone, or an image formed by the art and imagination of mortals. While God has overlooked the times of human ignorance, now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will have the world judged in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed, and of this he has given assurance to all by rising from the dead. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, because he abides with you, and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me, because I live, and you also live. On that day, you will know that I am in the Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have kept my commandments and keep them are those who love me. And those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them." This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Two steps forward, one step back. This seems to be the kind of world we are living in right now. We can only step so close to our loved ones. And some days it looks like we take a step towards some kind of normal life again. But then something always seems to make us step back again. A plexiglass shield, a sneeze or a cough by a stranger, another statistic on the news that is giving us a new reality check, a gloomy day like the ones we've had recently, feeling all alone again, or that now familiar feeling of worry and sometimes even depression. At times like these, when we have to take two steps back to see our grandchildren, our loved ones, our friends, and our church family, or when we have to stay isolated, we start to really feel alone. And not just in a physical sense, but in every aspect of our lives. It's hard for us to feel close when we can't see or touch each other. Recently, an article was published by the Washington Post that talked about the toll this pandemic has been having on our mental health. The article said an emergency hotline for people in emotional distress registered more than 1,000%. A 1,000% increase in April compared to last year. In addition to the stress people are feeling in their regular lives, so many now are weighed down with the enormous amounts of worry and fear about jobs and finances, their own health and safety, and the health and safety of their families. And if it wasn't enough on our plates, now maybe for the first time, people are feeling alone and feeling empty, without that normal connection they once had. And that makes everything feel much, much worse. In these days, something always reminds us that even when we think we can take those steps forward, another thing makes us stumble and pushes us back. As we navigate our way through this pandemic, I've been in regular contact with many, many people. Some of you, healthcare professionals, and other pastors. And one of the topics, one of the concerns that keeps coming up over and over again is that there is a difference between being alone and being lonely. You see, some people like to be alone, and that's okay. But as far as I know, no one wants to feel lonely. And maybe that is why, with all the insightful things Jesus says today in our gospel message, the words that I keep coming back to, the words that ring in my ears as I read this week, are, "I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you." At this time in our lives, in our current reality, I can't think of better words of comfort from Jesus than these. "I will not leave you," Jesus says, "even if you can't see me. I am here. I am coming to you to be with you." As members of the body of Christ and members of a church family, we know this to be true. We know that we were not created to be alone or live alone. We hear it in the teachings of Jesus. We pray about it, and we sing about it quite often. We were created to love and to be loved, to live in relationship with others. After all, that's one of the reasons we come to church together, to dwell, abide, and remain within each other as a community of faith. And even though being together right now isn't safe or wise, we still need each other, perhaps now more than ever. We want to be in a relationship. We want to be in a relationship with people we know will be there for us. We want to be surrounded, even if not physically, then spiritually and prayerfully, by people who love us. And you are not alone. I am continually moved and humbled by the way you are, day after day, there for one another, being the church, by showing love and kindness and compassion for each other and for me. I hear it in the prayers you've shared. I feel it in the concerns you have about each other. I see it in the growing list of church buddies. I feel it in the cards and emails that I have received. God is working through us. Jesus still leads us, and the Spirit is alive among us, opening us and connecting us. In these past weeks, I have found it astonishing that many of the gospel readings chosen for this time of the year, written centuries ago, Meet us right where we are at this time, in these inconceivable times. And although there are skeptics everywhere, I think it's pretty enlightening how this irrelevant, outdated book, as some have called it, can still speak to us and be relevant and comforting for us today. In our gospel reading this morning, Jesus is preparing his disciples for a time when he will no longer be with them, at least as he is now. And Jesus knew that his beloved followers would be anxious, that they would wrestle with their feelings of loss and abandonment, and most likely some depression. And as I read the passage, it struck me that those disciples might be asking the same kinds of questions we might find ourselves asking right now, as we are blindsided, as they were blindsided by a world-rocking news, not sure what tomorrow will bring, and facing a new reality. What will I do now? Who's going to be there with me? What happens next? What will be life be after all this is over? But Jesus gives them a promise. Jesus says he will not leave them, and although they may not see him, God will send them a spirit, an advocate, another one to guide and love them and care for them and look over them. And they will know this because this spirit will abide in them. As I said a few weeks ago, when I feel anxious or alone, this is what I hold on to, that the Spirit Jesus sent is here and abiding in me. And just like the disciples, I know that we do not pass through these hard times in total darkness. We are not being led through the shadows, but we are guided by the light of the Spirit. And we are not alone. Jesus reassured his disciples with the coming of the Spirit. When they were fearful about the future, what the future might hold and what tomorrow might bring, what life would look like when they could no longer do what they have always done, when they could no longer have who and what had made them feel safe and comfortable and normal in their life. And today, Jesus continues to reassure his disciples, you and I, who are also scared about what the future might hold and what tomorrow might bring. We who daily face challenges and adjustments, we who are seeking to live in the Spirit, separated yet together, that he will never leave us, that he is with us in all our fear, and we are not or ever will be alone. May Christ's infallible presence and promises be the reason you feel less alone this day and in the days ahead. And may the Spirit move within us and among us as we take two steps forward, abiding with one another in challenges and the uncertainty of the days ahead. Amen.
Please stand and die.
Join me now as we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Uplifted by the promised hope of healing and resurrection, we join the people of God in all times and in all places in praying for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Abiding God, you have revealed yourself to us in the form of your Son, Jesus Christ. Inspire your church as your followers to reveal your love to everyone in our speaking and in our living. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You are the creator of heaven and earth. Revitalize the health of oceans, rivers, lakes, springs, glaciers, and other bodies of water that give life to your creatures. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Come to the aid of your children. We pray for those engulfed in grief and for all who are isolated, powerless, or afraid, that all may rest their anxieties in your care. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give courage to all who embark on new ventures. We especially remember this day those who risk their lives to serve in our armed forces. Grant safety to those serving at home or abroad, and assure them of your never-failing strength. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You remain with us always, O God, and your kingdom has no end. We remember the saints who have gone before us. Unite us forever in your final victory over death. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. With bold confidence in your love, Almighty God, we place all for whom we pray into your eternal care. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, we pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the one who brought forth Jesus from the dead raise you to new life, fill you with hope, and turn your mourning into dancing. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. Amen. Christ is risen just as he said. Peace be with you. Share the good news. Alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia.